Joining me today in the Capital TV show, David Daoud, Hezbollah research analyst for UAI. Mr. Daoud, good evening.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much.
My first question will be on the latest update. Saudi Arabia announced it foiled the smuggling attempt of 14.4 million amphetamine pills from Lebanon into the kingdom. And everybody knows that Hezbollah is involved. What is your approach?
I mean, look, this isn't something new. You know, what was it, a few months ago, we also, the kingdom foiled an attempt by was it Lebanese produce? Was it in Makdous, of all things? They found cocaine. So this has been an ongoing problem. You know, you've had ongoing reports for years of Captagon pills being smuggled into the Gulf, into Saudi Arabia. Mm-hmm. Look, I think this demonstrates that the lawlessness that Hezbollah is promoting in Lebanon, whether they themselves are promoting producing these drugs directly, or simply granting the cover to criminal enterprises to produce these drugs, to smuggle them into the kingdom, they also have a benefit. I mean, we see this particularly from an analogous example with the Israelis, that there are clans in the Bekaa who produce marijuana and other drugs and smuggle them into Israel. Mm-hmm. And now Hezbollah hasn't created these clans, these criminal families, but they use those drug and criminal networks to pass weapons on into affiliates in Israel and the Palestinian territories, to pass on cash, to receive intelligence, you know, to pass on information. So for them, of course, there's the economic benefit that they're tapped into, but there's also a military benefit. And I would think that in the case of Saudi Arabia, given that it's confronting another pro-Iranian militia, the Houthis, there's also a benefit for Hezbollah to establish networks into the kingdom and use these criminal networks to develop intelligence, develop plans of attack, and possibly pass on that information to the Houthis.
Good clarification. On another side, U.S. officials, the Iraqi Hezbollah is behind, they said, the Iraqi Hezbollah is behind attacks we were exposed to recently. And in return, U.S. strike was targeting the Syria-Iraq border that killed five militia fighters. How do you see the confrontation here?
Look, I think this goes back to the promise that the resistance axis and Nasrallah himself, said would happen after Qasem Soleimani was killed by former President Trump, when he said that American soldiers, he did the hand symbol, would come, straight into the region and would leave horizontally, that, basically they would return into the United States in coffins. Now, I don't think the resistance axis is going to be daring enough to actually attempt to kill American soldiers. What I think they're trying to do is try to make our presence in Iraq and in Syria as uncomfortable as possible. Perhaps down the road, when they feel that they're more strategically comfortable, they may escalate the attacks. We may see something, it's going to be a contest of wills. I think we're going to see, we could potentially see something like the Marine Barracks bombing that happened in 1983 in Lebanon, where, our stay in Lebanon under then President Reagan was tenuous. We weren't committed to actually staying in Lebanon to responding in force to an attack like the Marine Barracks bombing. And what had happened, instead of confronting, we withdrew. Similarly, we don't have an appetite for reinvading Iraq or maintaining a large force presence in Syria. So if the resistance axis sometime down the road feels that it is strategically a viable option for them to conduct a large scale attack against our forces, it's something that they could be preparing for. In the meantime, I think what they're trying to do, like I said, is make sure that our presence there remains as uncomfortable as possible. And with these pinprick attacks, we saw a similar strategy, again, by the resistance axis, by Hezbollah, against Israeli forces in South Lebanon from 1985 to 2000. Militarily, strategically, these attacks were perhaps insignificant. They weren't enough to defeat the IDF in the classical sense, but they were enough to kind of keep the stay very uncomfortable. And in that case, right, there were casualties. Right now, we don't have necessarily casualties.
Mm-hmm. You wrote an article saying Israel and Iran have been engaged in a low-intensity shadow war for over a decade. Yeah. This kind of clash has passed through multiple phases. Can you elaborate more on the main idea of this article?
Look, the Israelis have an interest, obviously, in preventing Iran from acquiring nuclear weapons. This is something that they've stated, and this is something that predated Iran's entry into Syria. Mm-hmm. Obviously, Iran and Israel have been kind of locked in combat for since the Islamic Revolution, since the Iranian Revolution in 1979 and the rise of the Islamic Republic. So it, that confrontation has passed multiple phases, including, as I mentioned earlier, you know, the South Lebanon conflict. The most recent focus for the Israelis, I guess the overarching focus, is the Iranian nuclear program, which could pose an existential threat to Israel by providing Iran's militias a nuclear umbrella, right, sometime down the road. I think this is the main concern that the Israelis have. This evolved with Iran's entry into Syria, you know, after the Syrian civil war started, because Syria became now a base for Iranian entrenchment, you know, the precision guided missiles project that's supposed to be being developed in Syria, perhaps to protect it, you know, keep it at a farther distance from Israel, perhaps protect it behind, you know, Syrian and Russian aerial defense systems. So these concerns have kind of, you know, become wedded for the Israelis. There are two tracks of what the Israelis are trying to combat, both the entrenchment in Syria and the Iranian missile program. So the Israelis obviously haven't gone to war, but they've conducted what they call the war in between the wars against Hezbollah and in a sense also against Iran. You know, in the early, you know, in the late, sorry, 2000s, early decade of the 2010s, right, there were assassinations against several figures in Iran involved in the nuclear program. And that, you know, there was the aerial strikes in Syria. So we've seen this kind of as an ongoing process. For the most part, Iran refrained from responding. They kind of absorbed the blows, kind of considered it part of the confrontation with Israel as a price to pay. You know, this is something Nasrallah even said, you know, when Qasem Soleimani was killed, that, you know, there are prices that are going to have to be paid. This is part of the battle. And they had a longer strategic goal, right, to entrench themselves further in Syria, to you know, on the Iranian side, to proceed with the nuclear program. Had they prematurely engaged in a war with Israel, responded in force, I think that project would have been rolled back. They might have had an impact on them like what we saw in 2006, where, you know, Hezbollah prematurely engaged Israel in a war. So I think they've been absorbing the blows for the most time. Yeah. So what we're seeing, I guess, in the last phase of this war is, or this shadow conflict, is Iranian emboldenment that we haven't seen before, perhaps because they feel more comfortable regionally. And part of that, I think, is that they feel more comfortable internationally, given that the American, the Joe Biden administration is now engaging them in talks on the nuclear issue again.
What did Iran's election tell us about where it's headed?
I think very little, to be honest. I mean, I know there's a dialogue here in the United States on moderates versus hardliners. I think ultimately the decisions that matter to us as the West and that matter regionally come from Supreme Leader Khamenei. And whether it's under Rouhani or whether it's under the, you know, the arch moderate Khatami, or whether it's under a hardliner like Raisi or Ahmadinejad, what we've seen is Iran, a consistent Iranian destabilization of the region, support for militia groups. And I don't think that will necessarily change under Raisi.
Bennett warns the Hamas, saying Gaza will have to get used to a different Israeli approach. What does it mean?
I think, look, current Prime Minister Bennett, you know, when he was in different positions in the Israeli government, he was always taking a more hardline position than Prime Minister Netanyahu, in a sense, as a right-wing foil. What we've seen recently, right, he created an equation prior to becoming prime minister that even incendiary balloons being sent from Gaza into Israel would be met with Israeli retaliatory strikes on Hamas. And we've seen this new equation in operation. And I think part of it is the new government trying to prove its durability and trying to prove itself after 12 years of Prime Minister Netanyahu. And you know, this is the new, it's going to be a harsher approach. I think Bennett is going to take a more hardline approach to Hamas provocations and isn't going to give them the leeway that perhaps was given for, say, incendiary balloons or excuses to say rebel groups, carried out attacks from Gaza.
So Hezbollah Deputy Secretary General Naim Qassem said resistance is the solution until Israeli tires, panics, and loses internally, until it loses the domestic support for its existence. Is it a slogan that we all know?
I think, look, it's part slogan, part, I mean, it's hard to tell. I think Hezbollah in general misunderstands the Israelis' connection to their country. They think they're transients. They connect them with, at least in their propaganda, right? They connect them to the Crusaders, that if you put enough pressure, the Israelis will leave, right? There's the whole narrative that every Israeli has a second passport and is kind of always with their bag and ready to leave. It's hard to tell for me whether that's propaganda for their base to say, like, stick with the resistance, we're going to make the Israelis leave, right? They're not a permanent presence, or whether they actually believe it. If they do actually believe this, I think they misunderstand and underestimate Israeli society's connection to its land and its staying power.
Mm-hmm. U.S. warns Venezuela, Cuba to turn away Iranian troops believed to be carrying arms. In which way can the U.S. administration face this threat?
Look, I think if it were up to me, which it's not, but I would condition continuing nuclear talks on increased Iranian responsible behavior globally. But we've demonstrated, I guess the Biden administration has demonstrated that it is willing to go along with the Iranian principle that this will only be focused on the nuclear file and nothing else. But we should condition. I think the United States should condition continued talks, continued sanctions relief, continued reintegration into the global economy on a decrease in Iranian problematic behavior, both regionally and globally, including smuggling weapons to Venezuela or elsewhere.
The Daily Mail announced that Iran's Ghost Armada of 123 sanctioned busting tankers is selling black market oil to China. This is another way of smuggling. How do you think about it?
Look, I mean, Iran is going to, it doesn't surprise me. Iran has probably been busting sanctions in different ways. We know that Nasrallah in Lebanon has been talking about bringing fuel to Lebanon for lira and in any way to bring money to Iran. I think China has an interest in kind of circumventing U.S. sanctions. Right, China is one of our greatest competitors globally. So I don't see the Chinese necessarily having a problem with taking in maybe cheaper Iranian oil that undermines the U.S. interest.
I have a quick question. Do you think the decision of withdrawing from Afghanistan is a wrong decision taken by the Biden administration?
Look, I think it's complicated. We've been in Afghanistan for 20 years now, and there's only so much that a country can do before it gives up. Not gives up, but to say that there's only so much that we can accomplish. There's a less of an American appetite, I think, for these indefinite deployments, particularly in a country where our forces are exposed to harm. At the same time, mission hasn't been accomplished in Afghanistan in the sense that we're virtually certain that when we withdraw, the Taliban will take over or at least push back, the Afghani government considerably. So on the other hand, there is this idea that our efforts for 20 years will have been wasted in vain. So it's a complicated choice, and I don't envy the Biden administration in making it.
What about the Houthis targeting again the Saudi territories after removing them from the terror list? Is it a green card? It was like a green card or a green light to go further in their attacks?
Look, I think it was a green light for Iran generally to signal that a new U.S. approach under the Biden administration had emerged from the Trump administration's so-called maximum pressure strategy, and we saw this also in Lebanon when Lokman Slim was murdered. Neither Secretary of State Antony Blinken nor Ambassador Dorothy Shea mentioned even his role as a Hezbollah critic, let alone the potential role of Hezbollah and his murder. These things happened, right? The delisting of the Houthis and Lokman Slim, the softening of the tone on Lokman Slim on Hezbollah when Lokman Slim was murdered, happened around the same time. And I think it's signaling to Iran that as we're negotiating with them on the nuclear portfolio, we're not going to be pressing the militias issue and their regional destabilization. That could in turn embolden these militias to take further action against U.S. interests in the region and U.S. allies.
Do you think that the Abraham Accord was considered as an abundant of the Palestinians, which is, can UAE be blamed for signing this accord?
Look, I think the UAE and Israel have strategic common interests. I think it would be a mistake to kind of withhold those common interests that are in the benefit of the region until the most intractable problem in the Arab-Israeli conflict can be solved, right? The Israelis and the Palestinians are fighting over the same exact same territory. It's not like Israel and Lebanon or Israel and Syria or Egypt, where both countries can still exist and divide territory. I think the UAE could be a productive player in the Israeli-Palestinian arena if they so chose. In the long run, if the Israelis act responsibly, allow perhaps the Emiratis and the other Gulf states with whom they made peace to invest in the Palestinian economy, invest in Palestinian society, and give them an alternative option to, say, the one that, say, the Qataris, the Turks, and the Iranians have been giving them of resistance, resistance, resistance. But perhaps, over time, And like I said, in tandem with responsible and moderate Israeli actions, to see the Palestinian needle move a little bit towards reconciliation with Israel and perhaps a two-state solution.
Thank you so much, David Daoud, for your time. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you so much.